Hello and welcome. In this video, we are going to talk about zeros and poles. We will start with definitions and then we'll do the following examples so you really get the hang of it. The first definition is about zeros and states that a point C0 in the complex plane is a zero of order n for some analytic function f if the function and all its derivatives up to order n-1 evaluated at C0 is equal to zero, but the derivative of order n evaluated at C0 is not equal to zero. So, in short, a zero is a value of c, so that the function is equal to zero. And to determine the order of a zero, we just have to check how many times we need to derive a function until it's not equal to zero anymore. The next definition is about isolated singularities, also known as poles. And this definition states that C0 is a pole of order n for some analytic function f if when we multiply the function with c minus C0 raised to the power of n and then take the limit as c approaches C0, we get something that is not equal to zero. And that is exactly the same as saying that we should be able to rewrite the function f as the following in a close neighborhood around the point C0. And this is completely fine as long as we have a condition that the function g evaluated at the point C0 cannot be equal to zero. So in short, a pole is a value of c, so that the function is equal to something on the top, divided by zero. And from this we can draw the conclusion that the function cannot be bounded at this point. And some good things to know is that if C0 is a zero of order n for a function f, then C0 is also a pole of order n for a function 1 divided by f. And also, if f and g have zeros of order m and n respectively at c is equal to C0, then we know that the function h, which is equal to the product of f and g, has a zero of order m plus n at C0. And this rule can also be applied for poles. But since I'm a bit lazy, I'm just going to copy and paste here a bit. And then we just have to remove the words zeros for poles. And voila, all done. So, let's see now if you are able to solve some problems. Here I would like us to determine the zeros and the zeros order for each function. In the first case, we can see that c is equal to 1 is a zero, since the function evaluated at this point is equal to zero. And we can determine its order by deriving a bit. So the first derivative, evaluated at 1, is actually not equal to zero. And therefore, the order of a zero is equal to 1. And for the next function, we can see that c is equal to -4 is a zero. And its order is not 1 this time, since the first order derivative of a function evaluated at -4 is 0. But if we derive it once more, we can see that the second order derivative evaluated at -4 is not equal to 0, and therefore the order of a 0 is equal to 2. And now we can observe that the order of a 0 is equal to the power of a parenthesis is raised to. And this is a pretty neat trick, and will probably save you a lot of time moving forward. But just remember that you can always go back to the standard way. In the third example, we can see that the function will always be equal to zero if c is equal to odd numbers, and therefore these odd numbers will be zeros. And the order for each zero is going to be 1, since the first order derivative for a function is not equal to zero for these numbers. Okay, let's do another one. And I promise, this will be the last one. So, here we have a product of a function f and function h here above. So, since both of the functions have a zero of order 1 at the point 1, we get that the product has a zero of order 2 at the same point. And then, of course, we also have that c is equal to 3, 5, 7, and so on are zeros of order 1. Okay, let's do the same kind of examples, but this time with poles. And what we are really trying to do here is to look for places when we are dividing with zero, which you really are not allowed to do in mathematics. So therefore, if you are under the age of 18, please get a guardian and don't try this at home. In the first example, we can see that c is equal to 1 is a pole, since this makes a function divide by 0. And the order of this pole is 1, since the limit of c minus 1 times a function is not equal to 0. And a good thing to know is that a pole of order 1 is also called a simple pole. Also note that we could have solved this example by using the fact that c is equal to 1 is a 0 of order 1 for a function 1 over f, and therefore it must be a pole of the same order for a function f. So for the next function we can see that minus 3 is a pole, and its order is not 1, since the limit of c plus 3 times a function is equal to infinity. And now I just want to make something crystal clear here, and that is that we are trying to determine for which power we need to raise this parenthesis so that we get something that is not equal to 0. But we are still looking for a number, and infinity is a concept and not a number, and therefore the order is not 1. But if we take the limit when we have c plus 3 raised to the power of 2 times a function, we get that the limit is equal to 2, which is a number which is not equal to 0, and therefore the order of a pole is 2. And here we can also note that the same rule which seemed to apply to zeros also works here. In most cases you just have to check the power of a parenthesis to know the order of a pole. So now I have talked about zeros and poles separately, but what happens if we have them at the same point? We can try to answer this by studying this function f, which is a rational function made up of the function p and the function q, which both are analytic functions. Let now c not be a pole of order j for function f, but also let it be a zero of order k. Then we can rewrite the functions p and q as the following. P is simply equal to c minus c not raised to the power of k times an arbitrary function g, and the only condition we have on function g is that it should not be equal to 0 at the point c not. And then we have the same thing for function q, but this time we are raising it to the power of j instead. And by now inserting these new expressions into the function, we get the following. And the conclusions we can draw from this are going to be depending on the values of j and k. If j is bigger than k, then we have that the function f has a pole of order j minus k at c naught. But if k is equal or bigger than j, then we have that f has a removable singularity at c naught. And that, as the name implies, means that we are able to remove the pole for the function at this point. And we can even make the function analytic again if we just redefine it a bit. But that's a story for another video. So let's get going with some examples. Here we once again need to determine the poles and the poles order for each function. In the first one we can see that c is equal to minus 1 is a pole of order 1 by observing the power the parenthesis is raised to, and then we can see that c equal to minus 3 is a pole of order 2 since the parenthesis is raised to the power of 2. And then we have the last interesting point, which is c is equal to 1, since at this point we have a 0 of order 1 and a pole of order 1, and the point is therefore a removable singularity. And in our next example we can see that we have a pole and a 0 at c is equal to 0. And now we can use the fact that all analytic functions can be represented with a power series, and therefore we can rewrite the function sign as the following. And from this new expression I think we can clearly see that the function has a 0 of order 1 and a pole of order 3 at c is equal to 0. And this simply means that c is equal to 0 is a pole of order 2. Okay, that is one way to solve these kinds of problems. And just keep in mind that it is not necessary for you to rewrite the sine function as its power series representation. I just think it's a really useful trick to be able to visualize what is really happening. Thanks for watching.